by the Comedy Trust in Liverpool. And we were really fortunate enough to get a grant from Liverpool Clinical Commissioning Group earlier this year to put on 3 courses that are aimed at men as a way of trying to encourage men to talk about mental health a little bit more, so but using comedy to do it, because we realise it's a really tricky subject. Sometimes still considered a taboo subject. So the idea of the courses is to bring men together and they can develop their comedy routine. Some people mention mental health issues, some people don't, but it's also about building confidence and self-esteem and increasing their well-being as well. So it's been a fantastic opportunity for the Comedy Trust, and what you're going to see tonight are 10 performers who've been through a 6-week introduction to comedy. So they are newcomers and they've all done amazingly well on the course. This is the 3rd course that we've run this year, and hopefully we're going to get our funding continued to run more courses in 2016 and 17. So if anyone is interested and you're a man, then come and see me after the performance. I'll give you my number and my email address as well. So, but yeah, so it really is. It's been an absolute pleasure and a privilege to project manage something like this. And as I say, we've on to our 3rd course now this year, and it's really nice to see some of the performers who've been on our previous courses as well coming along to support tonight's participants. So really it is about now everyone enjoying themselves, letting yourselves go, being here to really support the people who are getting up on stage, because it's bad enough doing this, never mind getting up and then trying to make people laugh intentionally. So they've all been brilliant and you are going to have a great night. So without further ado, I'm going to hand you over to our compere for the evening, Mr. Sam Avery.
Come on, everyone, give a round of applause. Let's get it going. Thank you. Thank you very much. So, welcome, everyone. Hello.
Hello.
Welcome to the Feeling Funny Show. Thanks very much for coming out on a school night to support everyone. So what we've got tonight is we've got not one, not two, but 10. Fantastic comedian. It's going to feel like more. It's 10. No, it's going to be brilliant. We've got 10 comedians. Give me a woo.
Woo!
It's going to be brilliant. And they're going to come on stage. They're going to make you laugh. The stuff they've got together themselves. They're going to perform it for you tonight. You're going to love it. You're going to be dead supportive, aren't you?
Yes.
That's the right response, because we did this in Southport once and they went, nah. So, scary, man. It was good. So that's nice. That's supportive, like energy we need in the room. And very important thing that you just don't take photos of me, I'm signing on. Very important thing. We get to do that joke every time we do this show. I get to sit on the front with this camera and bang, there we go. I've got a stooge. Very important with this show, right? Because I know you've all come to see different people, haven't you? So give me a cheer if you come to watch a single person on tonight.
Yay!
Give me a cheer if you come to watch more than one person tonight.
Yay!
Give me a cheer if you just wandered in.
Yay!
Quite a lot of people, wasn't it? Just Jaden. The important thing is you don't just go, I'm only going to laugh at our Billy. I'm only here for Billy. I'm just going to laugh at our Billy. Oh, shite. Billy's not on. You're in the wrong room. Billy's not on this course. But it's going to be a fantastic show. So give me a quick cheer if you watched live comedy before.
Yay!
Okay, give me a quick cheer if you've never seen live comedy before.
Yay!
Pretty funny noise, nobody? Welcome. Welcome to the future. So it's good. Cheered then, who was it? Hello? Him? Do you know what? Nobody likes a snitch. That's all I'm saying. Where are you from, my friend?
Over there.
Okay, come in. Is this your living room? Have we interrupted Corrie? That's what we've done. What's your name, sir?
Ryan.
Brian. Sorry, Brian. Brian's very aggressive, ladies and gentlemen. Wait, no, I'm not! No, I'm not! Where are you from, Brian?
Liverland.
You're from Liverland? Okay, you do whatever the fuck you want. Not messing with Liverland people. The posh part of Liverland. What, Crosby? Liverland's alright, isn't it? Liverland's alright.
Sound?
Okay, that's the mayoress of Liverland, then, ladies and gentlemen. It's alright, I'm from McGull. I'm from McGull originally. Well, I've lost the room, haven't I? Anyone else in from McGull?
Yeah?
I need a lift home. So do you. Well, you're not getting in my car. Not unless you get permission. I used to get this living in Bogle. All my mates were from like South Liverpool, proper Liverpool. And when I was growing up, I considered myself a Scouser, but they didn't. They were saying, oh, you're not a real Scouser, you're from Bogle. You can't be a real Scouser. Your bins aren't purple. Like, all right, my bins aren't purple. My sister's orange. I qualify, okay? I'm in the club. Let me in. So it's good. So we've got Littleland in. Anyone else in from further afield? Give me a cheer if you're from outside the city. We'll go with someone over there. Who's who cheered there?
Me.
Oh no, that's Craig. I know Craig. He's from Runcorn, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Liverpool, sir. Weirdo. We get a grant just for having him in the room, so it's good. It's good. It ticks a box, doesn't it? It's boxed it, that's all it is. So it's good. Anyone in from overseas?
Yeah.
I'm fucking petrified on it. Where are you from?
The Wirral!
Come on, yeah! Yes. That's comedy, ladies and gentlemen! Comedy, we've got an asylum seeker, ladies and gentlemen, that's what it is! He's a tunnel dweller, he's come through. He hasn't got the one part. What part of the Wirral?
New Brighton.
That's like the nice part, isn't it? It's good and bad everywhere. Oh, that's quite a philosophical sort of heckle, isn't it? Still as good in things as bad in things. I mean, not everyone's perfect, but that's all right. What's your name?
Alan,
nice to meet you, Alan. You've got a lovely deep voice, Alan.
Thank you.
I do enjoy it. Not in a weird way, it just feels. Business. What do you do, Alan? I bet you've got quite an authoritative job, have you?
No.
What do you do?
Alarm engineer for the city council.
Alarm engineer for the city council?
Yeah.
You swore? I don't know about you, but that little woman's pretty angry about a few things. Do you not like, because you said city council? Okay, if you think that's swear word, wait till you hear the word twat in a bit, honestly. But you live in Litherland, isn't that Sefton? So what city council do you work for?
Liverpool.
Makes no sense, does it? It's what?
No, you're from Liverpool.
I'm from Liverpool. To be fair, I mean, that does end most conversations, doesn't it? You're from Liverpool, you wouldn't understand, that's fair enough. I definitely don't, but it's alright, it's going to be fun. So you fix alarms?
Yeah.
Like, house alarms?
Well, yeah, intruder alarms, burglar alarms.
Okay. And what do? You just like, it's all about wiring and sensors and...
Get a big hammer?
Oh, that taxpayer's money's not getting wasted at all, is it?
No.
Just, yeah, phone, what was it? Was it Dan?
Alan.
Okay, yep. I was just testing you. I'm going to be a hammer, you see, so. It's good. How long have you been doing that?
Too long?
Okay, yeah. That's it. A lot of miserable people in the audience today, ladies and gentlemen. I think you're in the right place. I think everyone needs cheering up. Who needs cheering up?
Me!
Who doesn't need cheering up?
Me!
Just one person just cheering questions in general. It's going to be a great show. Thanks for coming, folks. I really appreciate you coming out on a Tuesday night. Coming down to a comedy club, you know, for free. You've really made an effort. You've come down to a free show. No, I mean it. Thanks for coming. This is great. It's pretty much full. It's going to be a great show. We've got 10 acts, like I say. The way the show's going to work is we've got 5 acts on in the first section, then we've got a little interval, then we've got 5 acts on in the second section. In the interval, the bar will be open. The second half will appear funnier the more you drink. So it's up to you. I'm not suggesting anything. All the acts tonight are going to come on and they're going to do stuff that they've been working on for 6 weeks on the Feeling Funny course. Now tonight is all about them coming on stage, performing for you guys and getting lots of love back, right? It's going to be a lovely, lovely experience for everyone. Right now, they're all sitting at the back of the room discovering that the colour of adrenaline is brown, ladies and gentlemen. So I want you to be very, very nice to them and put lots of big rounds of applause. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to count to 3. I want everyone in the audience as a practice just to do a little round of applause, just a gentle round of applause first of all. 1, 2, 3, everyone clapping your hands. Now, this time, put your back into it, ladies and gentlemen, okay? 1, 2, 3, everyone clap and cheer. Yes! Woman with a pint, still clapping around. That is what I'm talking about. Now, I want you to do it again. This time, clap and cheer, American-style whoops as well. 1, 2, 3, everyone clap and cheer. Wonderful. Okay, this time we're going to put that all together. We're going to welcome on our first act. We've got 5 acts on in this first section. Each act doing about 5 minutes each. If something's funny, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to laugh. If something's really funny, give them a round of applause. Let's give them all the love you've got in the room. Make sure that round of applause that you give as they come on stage lasts until they get to the middle, because there's nothing worse than a big, big Live Aid style round of applause. And then it just gets to here, and it just... That was a little woman slapping her husband. You should have worked for the council in the 70s. That's the enthusiasm he wants. Okay, so I'm going to bring the first act on, ladies and gentlemen. Are you ready for your first act?
Yes!
Okay, it's going to be great. A couple of very quick rules. Please don't chat while that's on. Don't shout out, don't heckle unless they ask you to. And turn your phones off. Is that all right with everyone?
Yes.
Brilliant. Okay, I'm going to count to three. I'm going to ask you to clap your hands. Let's raise the roof, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome on our first act. Please, one, two, three. Start that clapping and cheering in the room. Welcome on the stage.
Gonna be honest, I wasn't too nervous, and then someone over here from Runcorn just started getting shit for being an asylum seeker, so I might make quite a hasty exit in a second. As you can probably tell by now, I do sound a bit different to a lot of you here. I'm actually from the south of England, and the fabled south England. Yeah, there we go. I'm glad Sam's told you to be nice. So I'm not actually posh, really. I just sound like I am. Which isn't, it's not a great combination in truth. In fact, out of all those combinations you could have there, it would probably be the one I would pick last. It's a bit like being a supervillain, but without any powers. Sort of like, think Darth Vader if he couldn't use the Force, you know, because I sound like a prick, but, that's about it, really. So I actually live in Kensington. And being from the south, I have seed made in Chelsea. So when someone said to me, yeah, Kensington is a great place to live, I didn't really bat an eyelid. But I'm going to be honest, and I don't want to ruin anyone tonight, but it wasn't really what I expected. You see, having watched Made in Chelsea, I was expecting, you know, maybe like a pond in my garden or something, but I just have razor wire. And maybe I was expecting like a butler in my living room would have been nice, but no, just got some of the local youths trying to acquire my television set. They're fairly harmless though when you tell them other people, you know, all right? So, in truth, when I first arrived in Liverpool, I didn't quite get the reception I was expecting. You see, because actually a lot of my family are from Liverpool, or my dad's side of my family are from Liverpool. This is very close to my head. just realise that, but that's quite far down. So, just trying to find a middle ground here. An interval in the middle of my show, that'd be nice. So, where was I? So I might do that again in a few minutes. Anyway, about half my family's from Liverpool, and I was brought up in Evertonian, so I people say, don't mention divisive issues, because you can only get about, like, half the people on side. And I was like, well, if I get half people on side, that's not bad at all, is it, really? So I started to take that. So I felt like most of my half my childhood was spent sort of coming up and down to Liverpool, and it felt like a second home in truth. So when I first arrived back in Liverpool to do my first year university, I thought you know, I might get a bit of a homecoming. I was quite naive. You know, there might be like banners on the streets like "Welcome home, Alex." People lining the streets with party poppers, you know, all that. Maybe like a cheese and pineapple hedgehog. There was no cheese and pineapple hedgehog, but this is quite a shit joke, so if you want to leave now, you can. But the reception was about as prickly. I do have about three more minutes, and I have been on first, so if you can just keep your seats, it'll be a bit fair on everyone else. So my first year at university, I found it quite tough. It was quite different. I felt like a lot of people simply didn't like me because of the way I spoke. Wasn't to do with anything about me not washing or anything, you know, it was, that's what it was for sure, yeah. That's what Mum kept telling me anyway. Second year of university was a lot better because I moved in with some Southerners in my flat, so it felt very homely, really. I don't know if you're aware of sort of customs we have down south, but basically, I don't know why. I think it's because you're sort of, wouldn't say we're subhuman, but there's sort of less humanity. We don't speak to each other. That's just like a thing for some reason. So like up north now, I've got used to it now. You know, I've been here a while. But if you see someone you know in the street, then you do the very normal thing of having a conversation with them. You have a bit of like a stop and chat, like walk along, and you have, you know, you see someone you know, like, oh, I'm going to have a conversation with you because that makes sense. But down south, we don't really do that, you see. Like, you could walk past your own mum in the street, like, oh, shit, here we go. You're just straight past, you know. So, I lived in this flat in second year, and it felt very homely, you know, because I had these two Southerners there. I mean, I couldn't tell you the two names of my flatmates, but I could tell you about every single pair of shoes they owned. Oh, yeah, right, what are you doing? Third year at uni is sort of pretty inherently tough and stressful because obviously your final year of your degree, but then at the same time you've got all like the holy shit, what am I going to do in my life after this? You've got the what am I going to do about money when like my student loan runs out? What am I going to do when all my friends move away? And it's funny because I mean you have all these worries throughout the year. You have all these worries and you know how it goes. You get to the end of the year and then it all comes true and you're like, what the fuck just happened? And it's like, why the hell didn't I actually do something about that instead of just thinking about it? But it's a bit late by then. All those things have come true then. And then my girlfriend got an email about this comedy course. And she said, you should go on, you know, you should be funnier, Alex, go and do this. So I was like, all right then. So I turned up. I spoke to Helen on the phone first. Helen was really very friendly, if you've just seen. And I was like, okay, I'll give it a go. Turned up on the first week, and I was a bit nervous in truth, but I mean, walking around Liverpool with sounding like this, you tend to be a bit on edge. And the first week was very relaxed. We just got to know each other's names, and we went around the circle, introduced ourselves, and we played a few games just to get to know each other. That's a bit weird when I put it like that. And then the second week was sort of largely along the same lines. We went round in the circle, we said hi, who we are, where, and everything. And then Sam was sort of sat at the back. He was sort of like the comedy. There was a lot of pressure on him, in truth, because I mean, like, everything that's sort of we're putting out, like, it's because of him. So he was set at the back and he was like, this is what you're going to do to be funny. So went around this circle and it was like, hi, I'm Helen. And everyone was like, hi, Helen. And Anne went, like, hi, Anne. And there was Stephen and John Paul. And it got to me and I'm a bit nervous about, like, you know, is anyone going to, like, punch me as soon as I speak or anything? So I was like, hi, I'm Alex. And it was straight out of the park. Absolutely loved it. It was brilliant. Got away with that one at first. And to be honest, I felt at home. I felt very at home because I was around like these really friendly people. You know, these really friendly people, and I've already said that, didn't I? And then, I got sort of like the reception. I guess I wanted all those years ago when I first arrived in Liverpool, and. I wasn't worried about like people judging me of how I speak or anything like this. Just felt very comfortable. And then I looked up and Sam is there. I'm like, oh, hi Sam. Sam looks at me and he says, you know what, you should do your comedy performance. I was like, what's that, Sam? He goes, oh, you're so fucking posh and different to everyone else. I hope you all enjoy your night.
Impression of me, I thought that was spot on, wasn't it? So Alex is actually from Hyde and he puts that whole thing on. It's all just Sawdust bullshit. That was wonderful. What a great start, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to have our second act coming on stage. Let's get that round of applause back to the room level four. Let's come on stage, the next act.
What's a Tom Cruise looking like doing stand-up? I was in town a few weeks ago in the town centre, and the chuggers are out, and the charity muggers. You've seen them, haven't you? It's pissing down with rain, and they come up to you, don't they? Hiya! You having a nice day? Well, not really, it's raining, you just stop me. But then they hit you with the question, don't they? Have you had any accidents? I said, no, I always look like this. Last week I was in Tesco's. I went in Tesco's and a little small basket. And I put a little loaf in, six small eggs, small pint of milk. Went to the cashier to pay for it. And the cashier woman, she looked up at me and she said, you live on your own, don't you? I said, how did you know that? I said, because I've got small eyes. And she said, no, because you're ugly. I've had one girlfriend in 35 years. One girlfriend in 35 years. To be fair, she was uglier than me. I took her to a party and she mingled with everybody. And my mate came up to me, he said, you're on your own, Phil? I said, no, I said, I'm with my girlfriend. I said, that's it, over there, she's diabetic. He said, she's diabolic. But to be fair, she dumped me. A week later, she dumped me. She said, Phil, I'm getting rid of you. She said, making love to you like making love to a Teletubby. I said, a Teletubby? I said, which one? She said, Tinky Winky. Have we got any service users in? Any service user? Service user, who's come up with that name? Used to be clients, didn't it, or patients? But service users sound like a reconditioned washing machine. Anyway, I've got a few moans now. One of my pet hates is bikes on pavement. So I'm not going to get onto that. I'm going to go on to dog leads. Extending dog leads. You've seen the guy, an old swan, with his dog lead. Fucking dog's in Norris Green. Dogs. Now I'm scared of the dog leads. They're going Home and Bargain. Home and Bargain. Now that's the Waitrose of discount stores, isn't it? Home and Bargain. And I'm going Home and Bargain. And I get my tea bags for £1 and I pay cash for £1. But I'm behind this woman and her young son. And she's paying by card. And she opens a purse and she pulls out more cards than the magician. I mean, at one point, she pulled out that many cards in a summer playing snap. But last year, I went on a course, a relaxation course, a six-week relaxation course. And you just lie back, don't you? Listen to the music and drift off. At the end of the six-week course, they gave me a certificate. Now, only in Britain, could you get a certificate for falling asleep for 6 weeks. The auntie came round last week with her husband, they're in their 80s now. She said, Phil, we're near the end of our lives and we're worried. So we're going to get our bodies frozen, the cryogenics thing, and our bodies brought back when they've advanced medical science. I said, that'd be a bit expensive, won't it? She said, £100,000. I said, £100,000 to put your bodies in blocks of ice? I said, get your coat and I'll whip around to Barclays, I'll do two for one. But I'm going to finish off now with a small poem. It's just a short poem. There's nothing like a visual gag. Nothing like a visual gag. I hope that you enjoy your night. But if you moan or shout, remember you got in for free, so pay on your way out. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Congratulations for getting here on a night like this, by the way. Thank you. We do appreciate it, honestly. Hey, right, and this will be started. Well, like, as you know, I'm John Paul. I'm 39, by the way. The things I like are, I like Frank Zappa. I like real, and I like real ale, but I can't have any because I'm epileptic. So I'm quite a grumpy 39-year-old, as you might call it. And one of my absolute pet favourite things to moan about at the moment is the way our wonderful futuristic city seems forever held up. No matter how many times you look around by roadworks, endless roadworks, you look around and every dual carriageway and every crossing, especially ones just over the road from a primary school. I don't know, maybe I'm imagining it all, don't I? They seem to just be sectioned off. And then dug up, and then nothing happens at all for at least 3 days. What is that about? It's all part of our moving forward to being part of the great northern powerhouse. To the future and beyond, and all that bottle. Least that does stop me from moaning over my moan of moans. Oh, the great and speakable evil one. My social worker. I don't know. As soon as you mention needing any kind of help with anything, my support workers over the years will tell you about this. All he ever does, as soon as you mention anything at all, is, "Oh, we'll help like what?" And I thought, and you think to yourself, hang on. Aren't you being a social worker, an anti-social worker? Aren't you supposed to, when I have problems that I bring up with you, suggest to me the way that we can actually overcome these trials and tribulations? Or have I not read the fine print somewhere and actually what it is? Is actually odd what it is. Oh, I'm going blank here. I'm trying to be going blank. It's the leg. Blame the leg. What do you get for getting false limbs and cash converted? But, oh. wank again.
I did.
It's not cheating. Sorry about that. Again. Oh, well, of course, that's the real reason that I'm mentioning these things about him is he probably, in fact, there's almost no doubt in my mind that he loves the new government buzzword, which is, hand on heart now, ladies and gentlemen, re-enablement! In case anybody's not anything to do with mental health and so on, you've not encountered that term before, what it is basically is the cosmic, spiritual, deep and meaningful mantra of re-empowering service users. Wait, hey. To provide themselves and each other with previously what were resource centre services. Hey. Which basically means, you know, it means bipolar sufferers providing support groups to substance misusers. You know, which all I can think of is the future's bright. The future's. Oh no, the future is a bit, it's a bit grey, palish grey. Oh, just leave it, forget it, okay? You've all been amazing for giving me time and for giving me a chance. Cheers.
He had a little brain fart. Did it bother him? No, he just went, I'm just going to stare at you for a bit. And it'll come back to me. And it did. Awesome, that was great. We've got two acts on left in this section. You ready for your next act?
Yes.
Round of applause again, please, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome on stage, the lovely Owen Stephen!
Hi, everyone. As Simon's just said, my name's Stephen, and I started doing comedy after I lost my job as a restaurant manager. What happened was one of my employees lost three fingers in one of the electric food mixers. Apparently, I'd done a proper whisk assessment. Okay, there's a Scouser. Scouser sitting at the bar, and he's a huge man. He's 6'5", and he's having a drink. And a gay man walks into the pub and sits down beside him. And after a few drinks, he plucks up the courage to talk to him. And he leans across and he whispers into his ear, "Would you like a blowjob?" And this huge Scouser, he's enraged at this, and he stands up, and with disgust and fire in his eyes, he smacks the man across the face and knocks him off his bar stool, and he continues to beat him all the way out of the bar and leaves him lying battered and bruised in the car park outside. And he just walks back in and sits down as if nothing had happened, and the barman walks over to him surprised and says, "I've never seen you act like that before. What did he say to you?" And the Scouser says, "I don't know, something about a job." The Scouser went into the job centre the next day and he said, "I've just been offered a blowjob, will it affect me benefits?" Thank you. A frumpy middle-aged couple returned to a Mercedes dealership, and the salesman's just sold the car that they were interested in to a beautiful, leggy, busty blonde. And the customer says, "I thought you were going to hold that car for us until we raised the £75,000 asking price. And yet I've just heard you close the deal for £65,000 to the lovely young lady there." He said that there could be no discount on this model, and the salesman's grinning from ear to ear, and he says, "Yes, well, you know, she had the ready cash, and well, just look at her, you know, how could I resist?" And then the blonde woman approaches the middle-aged couple and hands them the keys, and says, what does she say? she says, I told you I could get the prick to reduce it. See you later, Dad. Okay. Thank you. I've been Stephen. Thank you. Have a good night. So some of you might need the loo, might need a drink, just sit back, relax, and I'll make it seem like the shortest 4.5 hours of your life. I know what you might be thinking. Brian McFadden's let himself go since Westlife split up. tough times, not flying without wings anymore. all my life, I've had problems with school reports. I've always said, could do better. You know, must try harder, or my own particular favourite, when I was 7 years old, Mrs. Nielsen wrote, "The problem with Daniel is he thinks he knows more than he actually does." So basically I'm a lazy smart ass. She actually wrote that not long after Easter, because she got a poison pen out, because she asked us what we were all giving up for Lent. I leaned over to my mate Tom Revel and said, listening to her. Sorry, I'm just going to have some of this. The holidays are coming. After all this lazy smart-ass stuff, my dad said to me when I was 13, you'll go nowhere sitting on your arse doing fuck all. So I thought to myself, all these years, you know, coming up to 18 and all the rest of it, I'm going to prove him wrong. I'm going to prove my dad wrong. Now I'm making £300 a week sitting on my arse doing fuck all in the civil service. And some of you laugh too much at that. The civil service has got a bad reputation, man. You know, people think it's just full of cuddles and rainbows, but these are austere times. You know, we've had it tough in the civil service. In my first job in the Ministry of Justice, I was sat there looking out the window one morning, probably contemplating how to get a better work-life balance. I hadn't done anything for hours. And my boss came over to me and said, "Hey Dan, we don't look out the window in the morning. We don't daydream here in the morning." I said, "Why?" He said, "'Cause I'm nothing to do in the afternoon then." I've always been a public servant. I've worked for a few departments and I love it. I'm passionate about public service. I know I joke about it, but one of the things they're good for is equality and diversity. I went on a training course this week, homophobia and sexism and racism, it should be in the last century, and it's slowly getting there. I mean, the rise of Islamophobia, is it something to worry about, I was told? I mean, is it ISIS or ISIL? You know, it's kind of like when GIF changed to SIF. You know it's the same shit, but you're not sure how, like, whether it's stronger or weaker. But the one thing I learned in this course this week was that... it was 50 years ago this week that Russia first sent a woman into space. And as soon as she learns to shut up when the footy's on, they'll bring her back down again. too soon.
Before I went to the civil service, I went to university. I did a law degree, expecting a cheer, you know, but thanks, mate. But with my lethargic tendencies, I got B's and C's at A level, so I ended up in West Yorkshire's finest polytechnic, Huddersfield University. I'm Yorkshire till I die. It was a great place, but because I had B's and C's and ended up doing a law degree there, everyone who was doing, you know, a normal degree that wasn't such a smart-ass, twatty thing to do as I did, were doing, like, golf greenkeeping and patchwork design, dual honours or whatever. Didn't have the grades that I did, those B's and C's that, you know, keep the money rolling in. But I met this guy on who's a really, really good friend of mine, Big Dave. Everyone knows a Big Dave. But he got, he did a geography degree, and he got an E, an F, and a U at A level. I don't even know what a U is, but there's only 5 letters after it in the alphabet, so it can't be great. But when I was in Freshers Week, Dave introduced me to this guy who was on his course, and he actually was doing a dual honours degree. And, you know, I take the piss about myself about a law degree, but I didn't really hang out with anyone because they were twats. So I hung around with Dave and some of the mates he introduced me to. And there was this one guy who, some people get a bit arsey when you say I do law, because they think you're a smart ass, and like I said, I do think I'm a smart ass. And he said, well, you know, I was contemplating doing law, but I did geography and finance for the transferable skills. Strange one. So being the smart ass that I was, I said, all right, mate, yeah, geography and finance, transferable skills, yeah, yeah. Where's the cash machine, dickhead? He beat me to death with his calculator. That was that, really. Holidays are still coming, and I hope you noticed my cheat sheet now. It was in second year university that things went awry. Or sorry, should I say my first second year university? Or if you look at my CV, my year in industry. But the only thing industrial was the volume of intoxicants I was consuming on a daily basis, both legal and illegal. University didn't so much broaden my horizons as make it a bit squiggly and, like, purple, and, you know, multicoloured at times. It was good times. No, it wasn't. It was depressing times, and that's when I got diagnosed with depression. It went undiagnosed for a while because my symptoms were, you know, playing Xbox for hours, getting stoned, and excessive masturbation, so it could be student life. You know, I got sorted and I got medicated and all the rest of it, and life got back on track. And, you know, I looked at the positives. The life wasn't, you know, it wasn't always 5% empty, the glass, or in my case, I'd see a full glass and think it's about to be tipped over at any moment. And then, you know, I thought it could be worse. You know, it could be, well, my granddaughter, she got the big C, dyslexia. I'm joking. She didn't have the big C. I'm sorry if anyone did. I'd want to go, like, peacefully in her sleep, unlike the passengers in a car. That's not true either. Where was I? Oh, yeah, Big Dave, the idiot that we all love. No, we weren't there, sorry. No, that's not where we were. That's the byproducts of incessant drug abuse. I'm losing my train of thought. Because I was in university and took 4 years to do a 3-year course, I was the only person left in the house, apart from me and Big Dave. Big Dave had got a job working in a bar, being a bit of a man about town. But I was left in the last month of university doing my dissertation on a light-hearted subject, the moral, legal and ethical implications of euthanasia. Not kids in China, assisted suicide for those of you that don't know. So I was sitting there for weeks on my own, not seeing anyone, and there was a knock on the door, and I was glad of someone to talk to be frank, and there was this black kid with cool cornrows and sweet trainers carrying a clipboard, and he said to me, oh, what's your thought on God? I said, oh, I was brought up Catholic, but I'm a bit of an atheist, you know, I'm actually doing something quite ethical at the minute, so I've got a lot of this shit on my mind, lad. I said, "You a student?" He said, "Yeah." I said, "Oh, all right." I thought he was doing a research for his dissertation. I said, "Come in, have a cup of tea." When I was boiling the kettle, I realised it was a Jehovah's Witness. I sat this kid down, and you know, it was unbeknown to me that following the path of Jesus, you've got to do it in Adidas Gazelles. And so I'm sitting there chatting to him. I was having a bit of fun, and I thought to myself, I'm going to turn this guy. He wants me to come down to Kingdom Hall. Fuck that. I am going to turn him. You know, the weeks went by. He came back every Friday afternoon, and he'd bring me paraphernalia about the shit I talked about the week before. You know, like, why does God do bad things? And he'd bring back this leaflet citing scripture and shit like that. And then he asked me, when did you first start having doubts about God? I said, I remember the exact moment, mate. I was 16, it was 1998. And in typical the way my mind works fashion, it was a strange moment. It was my deep philosophical thoughts mired with the shit pop culture I watched. It was the 1998 MOBO Awards. And Destiny's Child had just won Best International Artist. It was like, it wasn't a case of TLC were robbed, why God, why? It was because Destiny's Child got off and Beyonce said, you know, first thing she said was, "I'd like to thank Jesus for giving me this award." I thought, no, that was Richard Blackwood. I was like, I don't think Britain's answer to Will Smith is the Son of God. And if he is, his number two smash hit, Mama Who the Man, has a different vibe about the Virgin Mary. So I said that, and he eventually stopped coming round, and I thought to myself, well, I hope it's because I questioned his circular belief systems, but it's probably because I was wearing Nike Air Pegasus. And, you know, the Greek mythology didn't tie in too neatly with his Christianity. I'm going to leave you with a quick update on how Big Dave the Idiot is doing. He got onto a master's course at LJMU, would you believe it, doing urban planning. And we still rock on like the good old party days of university. I was round at his recently watching a modern day adaptation of Guy Fawkes. The party days never stop. It was great, and it got to the end of it, and Dave the Idiot that he is turned to me and said, "That was really good, really, really good. But I thought he was going to blow it up at the end." If you're not laughing at that, you're part of the problem, ladies and gentlemen. And so I said to him, this is the last thing I'll leave you with. I said to him, "Right, Dave, I'm not going to explain any more shit that we watch anymore." So we sat down and watched Lord of the Rings. Start to finish, don't ask me any questions. Sit there, cup of tea, got to the end. Said, "What do you think, Dave? You know, what do you think, Frodo, Bilbo, going tumbling over the hill, all the rest of it?" Dave turned to me. "Must have been terrible in those days." Said, "Mate, you should have done history." Thanks.
Dan is technically the first Feeling Funny participant to ever get a sponsorship deal, ladies and gentlemen, with Coca-Cola. What an awesome corporate man he is. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have an interval. Before we have an interval, we've got a clipboard that we're going to leave on the end of the bar. I'm basically just asking for your name, contact details, any comments about today. You might want to hear updates about the courses, or you might want to get involved in some of the future projects that we've got going on as part of this Feeling Funny project. So I'll leave that over on the bar if you want to pop your name on it. It's not essential, don't worry, I'm not going to be watching you. But if you do want to do it, that'll be great. Before we go for the interval, we're going to have a 20-minute break. Can we get a massive... massive round of applause for all five actors in that day. Absolutely amazing. We'll see you in 20 minutes. Thank you very much. See you again. Anyone? Yay! Quite a lot of people? Anyone have a poo? Yay! Just the guy over there didn't even leave his seat. Just, that's run call, ladies and gentlemen. That's great. Every game he says that, man. So good, the front row have disappeared, but that's alright. I don't know where they are, but they're putting me to the back. But how you doing? I didn't know you two are quite big fellas, I'm quite scared of you in a nice way. You what?
I wasn't talking about her.
No, now I'm petrified. Okay. Are you two related or?
Related.
The questions might get more difficult. I mean, that's... if you're related and a couple, we're back to run corn again. I don't know what's going on. Doesn't matter. That's all right. No, you both seem like you work out. You work out. Used to. Okay. You know, you say someone's work out, they just go, yeah. Wait, like what? Sort of like weights. Or just
weights.
Like
weights, yeah.
Weights and that. Weights and like.
It makes it easy for you.
It does make it easy. I don't know what I'm getting myself into a conversation I've got no experience on. Clearly. Yeah, lad, we used to beat up comedians. Nice to see you again, fellas. It's good that you've come. It's good that you've come. Thanks a lot. And it's nice that everyone's here. Your body language there is just like, this is shit. This is terrible. There's a nipple thief about, so I'm going to keep my hands safe. It's all right. How you doing?
I'm okay.
Good. What's your name? John. Nice to meet you, John. Whereabouts are you from, John? From Waver Street. And what do you do, John? You're the caretaker. Oh, great.
For the city council.
For the city council. Don't throw petrol on the flames. That's what you're doing. A couple of little council references. In the... Was that all right for you, love? A couple of little council references in the first bit. Are you okay now? If he's from Waverton, let him off. We're just playing gobshite bingo now. That's what we're doing. I'm from a goal, so I don't win anything. That's all right. So are you caretaking what, at a school or
school,
a
yeah,
school? A school. So is that quite an easy job? Like little toilets? That's the great, the best thing about it. Like, so how many keys have you got? Normally you have like shitloads. Are you like a Scooby-Doo caretaker where like, I'm not accusing you of like murder or anything, I'm just saying. Is it all fobs nowadays and like fingerprint technology and
no,
like?
No, just fobs together.
Hey, here's a question for you. Does your alarm need fixing? Because I'm on a commission. He's gone because that woman scared the shit out of him. He's gone home. Do you know him?
I know him,
yeah. You know him?
Yeah.
Oh, is he with your party or?
Yeah.
Oh, so that's not less impressive, isn't it? Yeah. No, we do, yeah. Yeah, we came in the same car. Yeah. He lives next door with his mother. And I'm going out with him. I don't know what's happening. That's cool. Nice one. This is really nice. What a lovely audience, ladies and gentlemen. And how good was the first half? Yeah. Great. Every single one was just brilliant. And the thing is, a lot of the time with these shows, sometimes come along, like people like yourself, you come along and God bless you all. You really like, you're up for it. You want to help and you want to support. But I guarantee there's a part of you thinking, well, it's not going to be that good, is it? We're just going to laugh out of sympathy. But no. It was absolutely fantastic. Every single actor's done absolutely brilliantly so far. You've been a wonderful audience so far. We've got five more fantastic performers coming on stage in a second, and they're going to do the stuff, and it's going to be great. Are you all for the second half, ladies and gentlemen?
Yeah.
That's what we want to hear. So, I'm going to count to three like before. We're going to welcome on our next act, who I definitely think has got the most people here to see him. Ladies and gentlemen, it'd be really anticlimax if I said a different name now, wouldn't it? Or just a different person to what you're thinking of. I don't think you're here to see. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage, Gavin!
Just take my time, we've not all the way there, because I have to just try and remember everything what I'm going to say. Good evening, everybody. My name is Gavin McLaughlin, and if you take my surname, you'll actually realise it's actually got the word laugh in it. It says McLaughlin, like a laugh, Lynn, and that's as funny as it gets. That's a good laugh. Yeah, so I had went to see a careers teacher, and I said to my careers teacher when I was a teenager, I said, when I grow up, I want to be a comedian, a stand-up comedian, because it's actually got the word laugh in my name. So it's my destiny to be a stand-up comedian, because it has the word laugh in my name. And he sort of looked at me and said, He said, yeah. I says, well, if I take that A out of McLaughlin and put it onto Gavin, that is an anagram of vagina. And that's what you'll be when you grow up, head swat. Well, he actually said the C word, because in Northern Ireland we like to say the C word, and over in England you actually don't say the C word, so yeah, I won't actually say it. But anyway, November is Mental Health Month, and this course is all about mental health as well, so I thought I'd talk about my own experience. And 1 in 4 people, these are true stats by the way, so 1 in 4 people in the UK will experience some sort of mental health issue within 12 months. So that means between me and you three there, that one of us will experience like sort of a mental health issue. One of us is a bit fucking mental. One of us is a bit big cuckoo within 12 months. And I can see you sort of looking at me, and then sort of looking at my shirt, and then looking at my shirt again, and saying, "Well, I'm not fucking mad enough to wear that shirt, so it's got to be me." So by the way, I've got my notes aside here. I've just got to look at my notes so I don't forget. So yeah, so 1 in 4 people in the UK will experience some sort of mental health issue within 12 months. And also, as you can tell, I'm actually not local. Just in case you didn't realise, I'm actually about 40 minutes away if you're travelling by EasyJet. And yes, so I'm from Northern Ireland, and Northern Ireland in 2011, this is a true stat, in 2011, Northern Ireland had the highest rates or highest recorded number of cases of post-traumatic stress in the whole world. Which, I mean, the whole world, and you think how small Northern Ireland is, and some countries are across the world. I mean, some countries have like 4 different time zones, but Northern Ireland's small. Like, I mean, the last time I checked on the map, Northern Ireland's only that size. So it's a small country, you know what I mean? And in 2013, again, this is a true stat as well. 2013, Northern Ireland had the highest number of suicides within the UK. And also had the highest number of cases of self-harm in the UK. And they're pretty shocking stats. But I sort of, my own analysis, I put that down to drug abuse, because it's a well-known fact that Irish people are just mad for the crack. And also, post-traumatic stress as well. So post-traumatic stress can happen on a one-off event. It could be a one-off event, and also can sort of be highly susceptible to post-traumatic stress if you're sort of exposed to domestic violence. And having been exposed to the conflict in Northern Ireland and also domestic violence for 22 years, it is no wonder I am wearing a shirt like this. Also people will notice. I have post-traumatic stress, and a lot of people don't actually notice here because I didn't take any time off work. I was a martyr, kept on going to work, and I had I just had post-traumatic stress, but I didn't believe that, and I had to go. Things got so bad, I had to go and see a counsellor, but I had to go and talk to a counsellor about it. And I got in there, and I didn't believe it because I thought post-traumatic stress was only for people who sort of served who went to war, went to Afghanistan, Iraq, whatever. It's like I had experienced conflict in a wartime, in a war environment. So I had to go and see a counsellor and said, yeah, you've got post-traumatic stress. Here's a list of signs and symptoms, and take a look through that list and see if you can sort of relate to anything, see anything that you recognise. And I look through this list, so I'm looking at this list. Now, don't forget, I've got 22 years experience here, that's a lot. And I'm going, yeah. And I think, well, hell, I'm over an A plus here. I'm getting 100%. That'll be the first time I've ever gotten A. But, looking through this list, and the counselor says, so, tell me, like, what can you relate to? What do you recognise? Tell me one of those kind of signs and symptoms. And I said, self-destructive behaviour. I can see that there. Self-destructive behaviour. I had that. And self-destructive behaviour can be related to alcohol abuse or drug abuse. When I went to university, I became a prolific drug abuser, and my drug of choice was cannabis. And my sole aim in the day was just to get myself completely stoned, get myself completely wasted, just so to forget and to blank out all the memories. So that was my sole aim. And come to think about it in hindsight, I was very successful, doing a very good, I did a sterling job, did a great job. In fact, so whenever I woke up in the morning, my first thought was to get absolutely stoned. Actually, I should rephrase that. When I got up in the evening, my first thought was to get absolutely stoned. And I did, I got things were so bad. Actually, the day I left Liverpool and moved to Manchester, My fucking drug dealer, he was heartbroken. He couldn't believe it. The things I was smoking that much, that whenever I farted, puff of smoke was coming my arse. Puff of smoke was coming my backside. And I sort of give it a whole 2 minutes to smell your own fart, you know what I mean? It's going to get worse in a minute. It's a bit like an anal blowback. And if anyone knows what I'm talking about there, you will be watching this. So yeah, so things were really bad. I just smoked myself into oblivion, and it sort of got to a stage where I almost didn't graduate. I almost totally flunked everything for 3 years because I was totally on a different planet. And I almost quit my course. You know, I only had there's like a month left, and I was going to quit my course with like a month ago. But I sort of got talked around, and if anyone who's familiar with like the sort of student curriculum, people will know about dissertation. And dissertation is a massive piece of work. That's where you get all your big results from, that's where you get all your big points from. And students get 7 months to do your dissertation. But I did mine in 10 days. I did mine in 10 days. That's going to be some sort of record. 10 days I did mine in. And I'm still trying to work out whether or not that is a mark of genius or whether or not to give any gobshite a degree these days. Let me just turn my notes over. There we go. Oh yeah, so... again, we're back to the list, looking through the list there. Laura Simpson says, well, what is it? I said, if I can say this properly, dissociative behaviour. Dissociative behaviour is when you isolate yourself from family and friends, you disengage with people, you don't want any human interaction, you just totally take yourself and remove yourself away from the situation. And that's what I did as well. But to sort of compensate for this lack of human interaction, I created imaginary friends. So first of all, I had one imaginary friend, Mogi. Mogi's my imaginary friend, and then I had another one, and that was Mousy. So I sort of gathered them up. So instead of getting rid of one, I had another one, and it sort of got bigger and bigger. So then I had like a little crew, like a posse. And then loads, and then I got to one stage where I had 305 imaginary friends. 305. This is not on. This has got to stop. This is ridiculous. This has got to stop. 305 imaginary friends, that is not normal. Stop. And it was actually easy to sort out. It was actually easy to actually deal with this case because all I did was just close down Facebook. And then again, last one, no, you're off one second. Last one, hyper arousal, hypervigilance was another sign symptom, hyper arousal. And hyper arousal can be triggered by like a sound, sight, or smell. And the counter says, so, let's check, when, how often, and what would make you go into a state of hyper arousal? And I said, well, Wednesdays. And then she said, well, how often? And I said, well, every Wednesday. She said, well, what's made you go into that state? And I said, well, it would be whenever the missus closed the door and went out to the big shop. Whenever she left and she went out to the big shop. She said, why would that send you into a state of hyper arousal? And I said, well, as soon as she's out the door, I'm straight on the internet porn. And she said, well, all right, okay, yeah, so we can sort of condone that because that's a sort of, it's a form of stress relief, and I said, no, it's not. I said, I grew up in a strict Catholic environment, and it's dirty, that's disgusting. It's a sin, and I'm going straight to hell. I'm going straight to hell. It's over there somewhere else. I don't know where it's over there. There's a bull's over that way, isn't it? There's a bull. Hell. I'm going straight to hell. No offence to anyone who's from Brittle, by the way. I've never been there. I've heard about it. So I'm going to go straight to hell. And
we lived just, there.
Oh, I'm really sorry. Is it hell, is it?
No, it's not.
Well, I went that way. With the wheels. Wheels. Any Welsh in here? I said, I'm going straight to hell because of this here. And she says, well, is that what you're afraid of? Are you afraid to go to hell? I said, no. I said, I'm not afraid of going to hell. Not at all. I'm just afraid when I get there, there'll be no Wi-Fi. Yes, but that story's not strictly true, because if you think I was going to get out of the big shop, there's no just no fucking way. Nobody gets out of the big shop. You've got to go to the big shop. Anyway, thanks very much, everybody. Thanks.
It's not going too well, is it? I'm a friend of Richard's, by the way. My name's Richard as well, but I was hoping it wouldn't go quite so bad. I'm not sure what to do here. Is Mark Roberts in the audience? Mark, we've been given a bit of support as we've gone along. Is Mark in the audience? Mark, are you? Mark? Sharon, then. Sharon. Any idea what we can help Rich out? Sharon? Maybe he's. Looks like he's calming down a bit. No, he's not, is he? Me and Rich, we know a bit about this kind of thing. We've been going to this mindfulness class lately. I don't know if it's all the rage. There's a lot of kind of techniques that we've been practicing together, actually, to try and kind of contain some of the anxieties about getting up on stage. And I'm just wondering whether that might help. Maybe if I go through some of the exercises, even just getting close to it, that's what I'm thinking. Sharing this with you, it's good of you to listen. So I think I'll do it. So very simple. Some of you are probably aware of it. You have a little guru in the group, Sheila her name is, and she kind of tries to get us to focus on our breathing, and usually you try and breathe out. And then you breathe in again. Nice of you. I'll go a bit closer to him. You're all doing this, aren't you? Sometimes it helps if you close your eyes. Train I'm on, you'll know that You can hear the whistle blow 100 miles, 100 miles, 100 miles, 100 miles. You can hear the whistle blow 100 miles. Should we get going then?
Stand-up comedy like that ever again. It's just amazing. Isn't it amazing? You know, we do workshops 6 weeks and every week people do like a new minute, and every week he'd just come back with another minute of breathing. But it was really funny and really well put together. We were all stood there going, that's amazing. You're just making a dirty phone call, but it's funny. It's fantastic. Someone walked in late, just thought this karaoke's a bit shit, isn't it? What's going on here? So, ladies and gentlemen, we've got our next act coming on. Are you ready for your next act? Yeah. Get that round of applause back in the room, ladies and gentlemen. Come on, everyone.
Formby Beach, and he's seen some little shiny thing in the sand, so he walks up to it, picks it up, and it's a lamp, so he gives it a quick rub, and a genie comes out and says, you've got 3 wishes, mate. So we fast forward, it's 6 months into the future, same fella walks into a bar in Liverpool, and he's got a parrot, and he's walking in with a dwarf, and the barman looks at him and goes, and then he looks a bit iffy, shall I serve him? He says, I'll give him the benefit of the doubt, because it's Christmas. What would you like, sir? I'll have 2 pints of bitter, please. Barman, 2 pints of bitter on the bar. And how much will that be, the fella says? Barman says, that'll be a fiver. The fella pulls out the biggest wedge of dough you've ever seen in your life. Says, here, mate, there's 20 quid, keep the change. So the barman thinks, thank God I let him in, that's a good sip. Pulls the 2 pints of bitter, puts them on the bar. Fella starts drinking his pint, but in a flash the dwarf jumps up on the stool, grabs the pint, swells the barman, jumps back down, sits by his side. What the fuck? The fella goes, it's all right, he's nervous, you know, get some wedge. Gives the fella 100 quid, the barman thinks, all right, I'll have that. In his pocket, goes back, gets changed, puts a new white shirt on, comes back out. By the time he gets back out, the fella's drank his pint. So he says, I'll have the same again, barman. The barman looks at him and goes, are you sure? He's not going to do that again, is he? Same time, the parrot's going, same again, same again, same again, same again. Cracks the parrot round the head and says, you shut up, I've got enough trouble with him here. So the barman thinks, I've got 120 quid here, so I'll serve him. 2 more pints. Fella starts drinking this, but in a flash, the dwarf's on the stool, gets a pint, swills the barman, back down by his side. You little bar, I'll kill you! Fella goes, no, no, we are, mate. He says, I don't want any money. Looks at him and goes, well, I do want money. Grabs the money, puts it in his pocket and says, right, what's happening? What's going on? I thought you were iffy when you walked in, but I'll give you the benefit of the doubt. Tell me what's going on. He says, well, it's a long story, mate, but 6 months ago, I was walking along the beach in Formby, and I seen this shiny object in the sand, so I picked it up and rubbed it. It was a lamp. Genie come out. He said, you've got 3 wishes, mate. And the barman's stripping the nail and says, and what were the wishes? He says, the first one was, I want an unlimited amount of cash for the rest of my life. So the barman says, well, okay, you've got that, I can see that. And what were the other 2 wishes? He says, well, the second wish is that I wanted an exotic bird on my arm. And the third one was I wanted a 3-foot-long prick.
Thank you.
I am an alcoholic. I'm a recovering alcoholic, and I live with seven other recovering alcoholics. And one of the lads I live with is from Yorkshire. I was in town with him the other day, and we're walking through Clayton Square, and he has terrible trouble with his piles, this lad. So we're walking through Clayton Square, and he goes, "Here, Frank, my ceramics are playing up, lad." So I said, "Oh, mate, well, there's a chemist here. So I've got terrible trouble with my table lines." So he goes in the chemist, and they're not back in the coming forward, Yorkshire people. You can tell the Yorkshire in a fact, but not a lot. So he goes into the chemist, and he's straight over to the counter. "Excuse me, youngin, did I get any ice cream?" So the lad in the chemist looks at him and goes, "You're in the chemist, mate, but they sell Cornetto's over there." In our house, one of the lads plays in a band, and sometimes he gets in early hours in the morning, and he has this habit of having chips and tuna bussies at like 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. And I had to be up at 4 the other morning. So I wakes up at 4 and I'm in the attic, and even in the attic I can smell the waft coming up the stairs, and as I'm going down the stairs it's getting stronger and stronger. And I hate fish. I absolutely hate it. That smell, since I was a kid, it's made me ill. But the only thing that's ever come out of water I've liked is Ursula Andress. And as I'm going down the stairs and getting near the kitchen, the smell's getting stronger. So I open the kitchen door and that waft, that smell, didn't remind me of Ursula Andress, but reminded a bit of my ex-wife. On a good day. Have you met my ex-wife? And I say, "Oh yeah, one of the lads bumped into her the other day and he said she's not really that well, you know. She's had to give work up. All the shoulders knackered, so she can't throw the harpoon anymore." Anyway, I'm walking in the kitchen, and as I'm getting near the plate with the tuna on, the smell's getting stronger. And I can only imagine, because I wouldn't know, it smelled like a brothel. Where the water's been off for a week. So I'm now feeling really sick, and I get to the back door. I've opened the back door, and I'm just going to throw up. As I open the back door, I hear this. Shit myself. There must have been 200 birds flying off around the garden, out of the yard. One of the lads in the house has decided he's David Attenborough. He's put all these fiend fucking things up around all the trees, all this bird seed, bird tables, fucking birds coming from everywhere. I went outside the front door the other day, there's a coach coming up. All these fucking birds getting off with suitcases, sombreros, forks and berries. Went in the backyard the other day, they're all in deck chairs. Two of them there talking to each other saying, "I wonder if we can get housing benefits." And a load of them are in football kits. The Eagles support Crystal Palace. They're all made up because they drew with Everton last night. There's the Owls who've got Sheffield Wednesday kit on. The Seagulls have got Brighton kit on. The Magpies, of course, got Newcastle kit on. They're still pissed on Sunday because they beat Liverpool. The only ones that could be noticed was the Blue Tits. And the reason why is they're all in the front room watching the telly, watching Everton. So yeah, it's full of birds. And I came in the other night about 4 o'clock in the morning. Put my key in the door, opens the door, and I heard this. Pitch black, the house, pitch black. Thinking, what the hell is that? So I walks over to the living room, getting louder. Opens the living room door, and I'm like, who's that? So it turns the lights on. It's David Attenborough there. With his shorts on, with the Uber. On one shoulder, he's got a fucking big hawk. And on the other shoulder, he's got a Kestrel. I said, "What are you doing?" He says, "I'm doing an impression." I said, "An impression, what of?" He said, "That band from the Whittle in the 80s. Orchestral manoeuvring in the door."
just one last quick
thing. These two women sitting in the front bay window of a big semi-detached house, and they're drinking the cups of tea. And one of them walks down the garden path, and there's a fellow walking in the gate. Walking in the gate, and he's got a big bunch of flowers. So they look at each other, and one of the women says to the other, "Oh, look, there's my fella. My fella. There's my fella coming in with some more flowers for me. That'll be me with my legs open all weekend." The other one goes, "Why haven't you got a vase?" Happy Christ, thanks very much.
Vaguely amusing. It doesn't warrant a smile, never mind a guffaw, or a chortle, or a chuckle, or a giggle, let alone a hoot, or a belly laugh. It's not funny. What that Donald McBride said to me about my singing. I knew she loved music, and she was a Catholic. So I thought, I'll sing that song Alleluia to her, that's the way to her heart. And even if it's not great, I'll get points for trying. No plan. It's not funny. I said to that Sam fella, it's not funny. But you know what he's doing? He's training people up to go out and make people laugh. Can you believe that? He's taken lads off the street. Never done nothing dodgy before. Go out and do that. Shameless. Well, of course he is. When you look at him, you know. Couldn't run about that fella. Couldn't find the taps, never mind the plug. That's the toilet, leave it alone. Keep flushing that, it won't fill up, you can't have a wash in that. Go and have a shower. You find him bollock naked outside waiting for it to rain. Get inside, you clown. I thought it was a singing course, you see. I was misled. I got there late for the first session, you see. There was a bit of rumpus on the bus. This lad saying to the woman next to him, "Where's this place somewhere over there?" These two fellas behind, being on the pop, start joining in. One says, "Sounds like one of them places downtown, full of junkies and girls with their tits hanging out." Well, the female element on the other side, not happy with that, you see. But it just encourages them, it just encourages these fellas. So one of them, they say, these women like say, "Excuse me," high voice. I can't do the high voice because my balls get stuck in my throat. "Excuse me, there's married women sitting here. We don't want to hear that kind of talk on the 86 bus." So this fella says to the other one, quiet like, well, so the whole bus can hear. He says, "Well, if they don't know all there is to know about a bra load of tits with a little bag of balls thrown in, there must be something wrong with them marriages." Well, the ladies are having their say again, you see. So the woman at the front turns round to them and says, "It's all right, love. It's nothing to get upset about. It's just real life, that's all it is." If this was what real life has come to, I'm glad I'm getting me pension. These two fellas are like the Muppets, like them two fellas off the balcony, so Jimmy Muppet. Jimmy Muppet says, What's the doing, yeah? Of course, it's real life. Everyone's got tits. You want to see Frank's tits since he's been on the medication? Show me your tits, Frank. Get off, will ya? It's not funny. My missus says to me, she says, you was a man when I married you. Now look at the state of you. Size 42 and still growing, and you can stay out of my drawers. So the woman at the front is turning to the other ones and saying, he means the wooden drawers with the brassiers in it, not what you're thinking. Jimmy Muppet, oh no he doesn't. So the bus is like a zoo, it's hoots and screeching all over the place, but it's not moving. The driver's in the passageway now. What's this? What's going on here? He says, low pay, roadworks, and now you lot. And look at you, half of you are on twirly passes, and you're wasting a gang of school kids. Well, this bus is going nowhere fast. I'm saying, hang on there, mate. I've got a singing lesson. If you've got a brain operation, I says I'm gonna need one of them soon. The way this is going, it's getting my head in. So I get there late, you see. I'm all flustered. I'm telling myself, calm down, like the way, calm down. I'm practicing my do-re-mi, so I'll make a good start. Gets to the door, can't hear no singing. That's funny. Slips in quietly. They're all telling jokes. This is 20 minutes in, being funded by the NHS. Don't say no, no. They're telling jokes. It's like, went down a corner shop, bought four corners. Slept like a log last night, woke up in the fireplace. You can't lose a home and pigeon. If the bird doesn't come back, it's just a pigeon. Jesus loves me, I've been told. I mean, I like him and all that, but it is a bit awkward now. Awkward? I'm thinking, I've got to make an intervention here. So I was like, excuse me, Sam, like, when do we do the vocal training? When do we start the do-re-mi? And then he tells me, comedy course. Comedy? You must be joking. I need comedy like I need a dose of the clap. I says to him, so what are you doing for people who can't sing? What have you ever done for people who can't sing? None, have you? You've never lifted a finger for people who can't sing, can you? He says, I'm a comedian, it's a comedy course. I said, don't make excuses. Don't give me that. I said to him, have you ever taken a good look at yourself? Have you ever taken one good look at yourself, Sam Avery? Looking at me like I'm weird. Just like that Donna McBride when I sang to her. Same look. But she's out of order what she said to me. I said to her, you wouldn't speak to a dog the way you just talked to me. She says to me, if my dog couldn't sing Alleluia better than you, it would have been in a pet zone a long time ago. Nil point. That's nil point and a kick in the balls. Makes your eyes water. Maybe singing on the bus wasn't a good idea. But what's happened to serenading? Where's that gone? Out the window. It's in the midst of time. can see this one day. One day, call me a dreamer. Call me a visionary. One day I can see this. One day I will sing Hallelujah better than that girl's dog.
Urchins and teach them how to do like different styles of comedy and then just go out and like rule the world. It's not going to work, but I'm going to have a go. I'm sure there's funding somewhere. That's what it's all about, folks. Ladies and gentlemen, we've got one act left. How good have been so far? We've got one act left.
Jen, I've got my beautiful girlfriend sitting here. She was due with the baby last Wednesday, you know. So she's come along to watch me and didn't want to miss it, you know. I'm actually an alcoholic. I'm a recovering alcoholic, you know. And I've been sober 17 months, and this is part of my recovery, confidence, self-esteem. It's been brilliant, you know. I enjoy things, you know, especially Halloween. I love Halloween, you know. This Halloween, the local community centre by where I live, it's too broke, but they announced a massive cash prize, you know, for this year's best dressed, you know, they said, big cash prize, you know, so I thought I'm going to go all out, you know, I've been down to Asda and I've got, I spent about £4 anyway, but I looked really frightening, you know, so, I went down to that competition and, you know, the missus actually won. She had to go to pick me up. She's crying her eyes out, telling me, you know, nobody likes her, she's got no friends, everybody hates her. I said, you know what, love, you know, I'm your dad, I'll be your best friend, you know, I'm your best friend in the world now. Now I'm not drinking. She said, you know, selfish style, innit? She said, you know, will you play house with me, Dad? I said, all right, love, I'll play house with you, you know, it's what house? So we go in the living room, and she's got like a carp, a little blanket thing, and there's about 9 dolls on the floor there, you know. She said, sit down, Dad, with the dolls. So I sit down with the dolls, and she said, we're going to check and see if they've pooed. So, you know, I said, well, what do we do? She said, well, we just undress them one by one. So, you know, fucking hell, this is going to take ages. I said, I've got an idea. I said, can you just sniff them? Good idea, Dad. She said, I'm just going to go to the toilet. You just sniff the next one. I said, all right. So, you know, first, I've gone upstairs. So I've got all the dolls and I've lined them up, you know, with their asses in the air. And I thought, you know, I've got myself a little plant, you know, I can be artist in 60 seconds or so. So, as the door's open, I hear the door open and I've got the last doll in my hand and I'm going like, oh, all done, you know. And as I turn and look, Sheila, the profi woman. I didn't know what to say to me, you know, she just said that, you know, I'm going to need more than a loan. I decided to take my girlfriend to McDonald's with the end of money she wanted, you know, on the Halloween. So we're going into McDonald's and we're just here, mate! Fucking hell, it's Dan, as it turned, the guy standing right next to me goes, mate. He said, before you go in there, I've got a once in a lifetime opportunity for a deal. You can't refuse it, it won't happen again. I said, did he end that road? He turned him out, she said, no, let's go in. I said, let's hear him out. He said, in there, £2.49. Just for you, for today, £1. And he had hold of a Big Mac. I said, he's going, mate. I said, will you stop calling me mate? He said, what's your name? I said, Jay. He went, mate. I said, you know what, I prefer, you know, I cut out the middleman when I get a new Mac. He's booked. He said to me, It was his pitch, you know. He got down on one knee and he opened this in the McDonald's. He opened it like it was a fucking Rolex or something. And he went, yeah, I mean, look, I've hardly touched it. I've got it for 20 feet, like, you know. I got in trouble for you, alcoholism, you know, and I had to go to jail once, you know. And the guard took me to my cell, yeah, he's walking me to my cell, and there was a massive guy in the cell, and I just carried on walking past, and he just tapped me and said, fuck's sake. So I was standing looking at this guy, he's just sitting there with his arms folded, looking at me, you know, and he's, what are you in for? I killed 5 people, you know, with my bare hands. He was fucking dead impressed. He said, how long are you in for? I just, 3 months. He said, no, you know, that's perfect timing for me. You know, he said, because you're going to have to be the husband or the wife here. I said, what? He said, you're going to be after a husband or a wife. So can't we just be cousins? He said, that's disgusting. I knew what he was thinking. He knew, thought I was going to say the wife, you know, because he was a big guy, and, you know, when I'll make his bed and wake him up and, you know, just clean him up, and, you know, but so I said, I'm going to be the husband. He said, well done. He said, come over here and suck your wife's dick. I've been James Long, thank you for all your support.
Jamie, baby! And his missus is going to be here in 8 minutes.
I did think that would have been a great finale to the show if you gave birth on stage. That would have been fantastic for you. What a great show. Give me an R. It's over, ladies and gentlemen. But thanks for coming. You've been a lovely audience. You've made it really, really great for everyone to come on stage and do it. I think the performers have done a fantastic, sterling job. Can we have a round of applause for all 10 of you? Everyone's got their own style, their own personalities come across to the show. It's had loads of variety through, and everyone's been absolutely fantastic. And every single one of them has stormed this gig, absolutely stormed. This has been great. Can I just get a couple of rounds of applause for some other people? First of all, for our preview, this is the third Feeling Funny course that we've been doing. We've been very lucky to be funded by Liverpool Clinical Commission Group, so we have a round of applause for them, because we'll be able to get a round of applause for just councils in general. I wanted the reaction from her, but she's too pissed. This is the third Feeling Funny course, and it's really great to see people from the first and the second Feeling Funny course coming back to this show to support them. Can we have a round of applause for all those people? Thank you very much for coming along. Your support is very much appreciated. And we also get a round of applause for my two partners in crime, which has been Helen Holden, who's been the project manager, and Anne Nelson, who's over there. Can we have a big round of applause for our two partners? A round of applause for Craig from the Comedy Trust, who's in the back somewhere. And a round of applause for all the staff from Baby Blue, who've been amazing. What we do on this course is we take people from the beginning towards this show. We try and offer a bit of support afterwards, so if anyone wants to continue, we'll give them opportunities to do that. We'll hopefully help them like find other gigs if you want to do that. When they first come to the course, what we do is we say anyone can do stand-up comedy, and that's a little bit of a lie because it's quite difficult. So every single one of these people has done amazingly, and if anyone else is out there who would like to sign up for this course, we've got more going on next year. Either come and speak to me, come and speak to Helen, or come and speak to Anne, or we've got our clipboard on the end of the bar, stick your email address down and we can send you details. I think it's only fitting that we end tonight by having a massive, massive round of applause for every single act that you've seen on this stage. And I think that's great. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you for your support. Cheers. Good night. Cheers.